In the U.S., it's estimated that over 100,000 people, the majority of whom are of African descent, have sickle cell disease and may require blood transfusions throughout their lifetime. Sickle cell is a genetic disease of the blood that distorts soft and brown red blood cells and turns them hard and crescent shaped, often causing individuals to experience extreme pain. Despite the discovery of the disease more than a century ago, there's been fewer health resources available to help those suffering from sickle cell disease in comparison to similar diseases, making it a health disparity. Hello, my name is Atiya Leach, and I'm the Sickle Cell Program Manager at the American Red Cross. While the number of physicians trained to willingly treat patients with sickle cell disease, especially adults, is limited, today I'm fortunate to be joined by Dr. Nadira El-Amin, a pediatric hematologist and oncologist at Children's Hospital of Richmond at VCU, who is here today to discuss some of the most common and not so common topics related to sickle cell disease. Hi, Dr. El-Amin, how are you today?
Hi, I'm doing great.
Good, thank you for joining us. I really appreciate your time here to talk about sickle cell.
I'm happy to be here.
Thanks. So sickle cell is a largely misunderstood disease, and perhaps one of those reasons is because of there's different types of sickle cell disease. Could you talk about the different types and the impact they have on patients?
Absolutely. So sickle cell disease is a genetic disease. It's an inherited disease. So you get it because your parents pass it on to you. And the type of sickle cell disease that you have is dependent on what traits and what genetic material that you get from your parents. The most common type of sickle cell disease is called homozygous sickle cell disease, where you receive a sickle cell trait from mom and you receive a sickle cell trait from dad. There are other types of sickle cell disease including SC disease and S beta thalassemia disease, and they can differ in severity depending on what type you have.
Okay, so you mentioned the most common type, and there's other types as well. Are there certain types that are more serious or fatal than others, or are they all pretty much kind of the same?
Yes. So, of course, anyone with sickle cell disease is going to have some symptoms of the disease, but there are certainly more some types that are more serious than others. The most common one, homozygous sickle cell disease, is usually considered to be one of the more severe forms. And then sickle beta thalassemia, there's a type that can be a more severe form as well. And then SC disease is generally considered to be a milder form of sickle cell disease.
Thank you. So do all of those different types need blood transfusions, or is it just one or some of them?
It's very possible that with any type of sickle cell disease that you have, that you may need a blood transfusion at some point in your life. Generally, patients with more severe sickle cell disease will need more blood transfusions, but everyone's disease is different. So it is possible that every type will need a blood transfusion at some point in their lifetime.
Okay, that's helpful to know that it varies among different patients and the types that they have. So sickle cell disease is sometimes referred to as the invisible disease because patients have learned to cope with the sudden onset or the severity of symptoms. What are some of the most common symptoms someone with sickle cell disease may experience?
So the most common symptom that a patient with sickle cell disease will experience is what we call a pain crisis. And that is basically where a certain part of their body will all of a sudden develop, you know, severe or significant pain. And they often need to come to the hospital to be treated for. But there are a variety of different symptoms and different consequences of having sickle cell disease. I always like to tell my patients that because it involves the blood, you know, wherever your blood flows is where you can get a complication of sickle cell disease. So you can really see complications from the top of your head to the tip of your toes with sickle cell disease.
That makes sense. I know some of the more serious complications could be like stroke, vision problems. And are those related to where the blood kind of gets caught up in the system?
Absolutely. So when you think about where your blood goes, it flows to every organ in your body. So, you know, starting from the head up, you can think about your brain. Patients with sickle cell disease can develop stroke, which can be a very devastating consequence of sickle cell disease. Your eyes, patients can get what we call retinopathy, which is basically really bad sickle cell disease in their eyes that can affect their vision. It can affect your heart. It can affect your lungs. Patients get something called acute chest, which is basically a severe type of pneumonia in patients with sickle cell disease. It can affect your gallbladder, your spleen, your kidneys. So definitely a lot of pretty much every organ that you have in your body could be affected because of sickle cell disease.
Wow. So you've mentioned like stroke and kidney. Are some of those age-related symptoms? Do some show up earlier than others?
Absolutely. So actually, when you think about stroke is one of the complications that we tend to see earlier in childhood with patients with sickle cell disease. And we do have pretty intense screening protocols for patients, for younger patients with sickle cell disease because of that. And then there are age-related complications that we see, like kidney disease, which tends to get worse as the disease progresses. Heart disease tends to progress as the disease progresses. But yes, there are age-related complications, and we always try to educate our families about what to look for based on the age of the patient that we're caring for.
So speaking of what to look for, at what point do individuals showing symptoms seek medical attention?
So we like to tell our patients that the earlier you engage in medical care when you have sickle cell disease, the better. So we start to see our patients, from the time they're born, to teach them some of the signs and symptoms that we see. In general, younger patients tend to have less complications, but you can start to have complications from your sickle cell disease as early as, 6, 12 months of age. And so, we teach parents about certain complications like splenic sequestration, where your spleen can become enlarged. That's a reason to seek medical care. We teach patients about how to recognize pain crises. That's a reason to seek medical care. Abdominal pain, if it's related to the gallbladder or something like that, is a reason to seek medical care. And stroke-like symptoms is always a reason to seek medical care. And actually, fevers are a very important complication in sickle cell disease, and we always tell patients to seek medical care with fevers.
Okay. So speaking of some of the symptoms and the complications, there's also the other side of treatment. Blood transfusions are usually the standard intervention to prevent complications, but also used to treat associated symptoms like pain crisis, like you mentioned. You talked about kind of a pain crisis and how that feels to a patient with sickle cell disease. What can cause a pain crisis?
So a pain crisis is basically caused by the sickled red blood cells that these patients have. So these sickled cells are basically shaped like a C or a sickle, instead of this nice round shape that we expect to see in a patient without sickle cell disease. And because they're shaped so abnormally, instead of flowing through the blood, very freely and easily, they get clogged in vessels, and that causes a lot of pain. Causes a decreased oxygen to the tissues that need to get oxygen, and that's really what causes the pain that patients feel when they develop a crisis.
Wow, I'm sure that's unimaginable for those not living with sickle cell disease. Are there certain things that can help alleviate or mediate or maybe prevent some of the pain crises, like lifestyle changes, stress maintenance, nutrition?
Absolutely. So because sickle cell disease is different for every patient, we do try to educate them about recognizing their own personal triggers. And that can be different for every patient. But there are some things that we know tend to trigger pain crises in patients. Changes in weather, going from hot to cold. Stress can trigger the body, and it can be any kind of stress, mental stress, emotional stress. All of those things can trigger a pain crisis. Illness, if they have a fever or anything like that, that can all trigger a pain crisis. So we try to tell patients to, dress warmly, prevent catching illnesses as much as possible, drink a lot of water, things like that to hopefully prevent pain crises. And then once they develop them, of course, there are a variety of different ways to help treat those once a patient develops a pain crisis.
So, speaking of the treatment, we know blood transfusions can help alleviate some of that pain. Can transfusions be used to treat any other complications associated with sickle cell disease, or is it just for pain crisis?
So we use blood transfusions for a lot of things in sickle cell disease. The reason that blood transfusions work so well is because we are giving a patient with sickle cell disease these healthy cells that aren't breaking down, and And in that sense, we can use it for a lot of complications. So we can use it for a very painful kind of refractory pain crisis. We also use it for the treatment of splenic sequestration, which I talked about earlier. We use it for acute chest. And in those circumstances, the blood transfusion can actually be life-saving. And we also use it for stroke prevention and treatment. You know, there are patients who are identified at an early age as being at a risk for stroke, and those patients are usually started on a chronic transfusion program where they receive transfusions every 4 to 6 weeks. And for those patients, those transfusions are very important from keeping them from developing, you know, a stroke and the devastating complications that come from that.
That's really helpful information. Thank you, Dr. El-Amin. So overall, you've given us a lot of good information on some of the basics of sickle cell disease, as well as the symptoms and treatment. For those of you watching to learn more about Dr. El-Amin and the work she and her colleagues are doing to support patients with sickle cell, through the sickle cell program at VCU Health, you can visit vcuhealth.org. And if you'd like to learn more about how you can help patients by giving blood or even hosting a blood drive, you can visit redcrossblood.org/ourblood. Thank you for watching.